I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers of opposition and the currents of the things of this world that would try to come against you, they will not sweep over you, for I have called you to overcome. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. Just as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, as they walked into the fiery furnace and they came out with not even a thread on their clothes singed. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord God Almighty. I am your Lord. I am your God, the Holy One of Israel. I am your Savior, your Redeemer. I am your Deliverer. And I will give you Egypt for your ransom. That which once held you captive, that which once held you in bondage, I will make ransom for you. Since you are precious and honored in my sight. If we only knew how precious we are to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The God of all creation, the one who set the stars in motion, he honors you. Why? Because he says, I love you. I will give men in exchange for you and people in exchange for your life. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your grandchildren from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up. And to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. That is God's cry this morning. As he's placed us in Bremerton, as he's placed us in Kitsap County, his desire is that those that live around you, those who want nothing to do with him, would come and discover the power of his grace and glory and would be drawn in to him. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I have created for my glory, who I have formed and made. All the nations will gather together, and the people will assemble, and of which of them foretold this and proclaimed to us the former things. Let them bring in their witnesses to prove that they were right. So that others may hear and say, it is true. It is true. What Jesus has done in your life is true. People could deny the word, they can deny everything that you talk about in God, but they cannot deny what Jesus has done in your life this morning. The truth of his goodness. You are eyewitnesses, firsthand eyewitnesses of the power of the glory of God. And there's no greater miracle, no greater miracle than for him to transform one from the inside out. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, so that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me, no God was formed, nor will there be one after me. I am the Lord God Almighty, the Shem Adonai. Amen. Church, we are here to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. We are here to worship a mighty God whose hand is not too short to reach into the depths of your lives, the depths of your family, the depths of your circumstances. And we need to shake off all the things that keep us from his presence, that keep us distracted. And we need to focus in on who he is and what he wants to be in our midst today. Amen? He says, apart from me, there is no Savior. I have revealed and saved and proclaimed an I and not some foreign God among you. You are my witnesses, declare the Lord, that I am God. Yes, from the ancient days, I am He. No one can deliver you out of my hand. And when I act, who can reverse it? The minor prophet said that God calls you His signet ring. I can't remember if it's Habakkuk or Haggai 2:22 or 24. It's one of those two books. I always get them confused. Now I want you to think about this as you worship the Lord. I want you to stand with me. And as we worship the Lord this morning, I want you to know you are declaring, as you lift your hands, as you lift your voices, you are declaring as witnesses of God that He is true, that He is good, that He is worthy this morning. Amen? Let's worship the Lord this morning.
Streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through a wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name. When the sun is shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, but it's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will sing. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of take away. blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to pray. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be the glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be the glorious name. Blessed be the glorious name. Blessed be the glorious name.
Hallelujah. Come on and lift your hands. Bless the name of Jesus. He's worthy of all your praise. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus.
We worship you, God. Hallelujah.
Good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. From every nation and tongue, from generation.
giving the praise. Oh, we worship you, Lord. He is good. Yes, he is. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Come on, if you believe he's good, come on and give him a praise this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Yours is.
what a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
I want to take this moment to worship Him.
The communion this morning. You may be seated. As we distribute this, I just ask you to hold on to the elements, and then I'd like you to wait, and I'm going to come and give some instruction with that. So as we pass that out, let's just continue to worship. And you do not have to be a member of our church to partake in communion, but we do ask that you have a personal relationship with Christ. And if you don't have a personal relationship with Christ, if that's not there, I want to just mention that is so simple. We're going to talk about that some more this morning, but it's simply just surrendering our life to Him and saying, Jesus, will you be taking the wheel? Will you be in control of my life? And allowing Him to be your Lord and Savior. And that's something we can do right now. We can do in this moment in a powerful, powerful way. Let's just worship together. Hold on to the elements, and we'll give some instruction in just a moment.
Freedom.
the night before, in the midst of the week of Jesus was betrayed and he gave his life, he was in the middle of the Seder meal and he pulled out the bread and he said, "This is my body. This represents my body." Paul in Corinthians tells us that we are the body of Christ and that he is the head. And we know in 1 Peter and James, it says, "By his stripes we are healed." And if you need physical healing, I want you to know that is a part. I've actually seen people healed in the midst of communion. I've seen that just unfolded, the supernatural of God. But the Lord has really been stirring me this weekend that the healing that needs to be addressed with us is relationships. There's not room for disunity in the body of Christ. And you know what? The enemy can come sometimes and he can try to tear us apart. And in my heart, I just sense there are relationships that may be in your life, whether it's siblings, whether it's parents, children, whether it's a neighbor that may have, the enemy has come in and has brought destructiveness. And you know, in that unforgiveness and bitterness and strife can come out of those things. And Jesus says, "Listen, I paid the price for these things." And I'll tell you what will hold us back from what God wants to do in our midst is those broken relationships. Now listen, you can't control everybody's relationship. Everybody has a mind of their own. How many noticed that with their kids? My kids grow up, you expected my kids, all three of my boys, to have my heart and my passion. I just assumed that was the case. My youngest was trying to explain to me last week, he was telling me that there's DNA that's passed down from generation to generation. I'm like, "If that's true, why aren't you going to church?" All right, I was a little hard on him that day, but I will say this, you can't control every relationship, but you can control your heart and your step. And if there's oughtness, if there is unforgiveness in your heart, that needs to be addressed. And I'll tell you what, we serve a God that does the impossible. And if we will address with what's here, he will take care of the rest. Amen. Let's hold the bread up. Father God, I thank you. I thank you for your body that was broken. I thank you, Lord, that you gave everything. Every strike, every step that you took on the way to Golgotha, Lord, was to make all things new. And Father, all of that, you could have at any moment called upon 10,000 angels to come and change the circumstances, but you chose to give your life. Your life was not taken from you. You gave it freely. And Lord, as we come to the day where I just pray that you, Holy Spirit, would just quicken our hearts. And we pray for, Lord, emotional healing. I pray for the brokenness of the relationships that are represented in this room this morning. And Jesus, I ask that you would do the impossible. I ask, Father, that as you have given us, Lord, let us forgive those that have brought harm, that have intended harm for us. And to recognize that, Lord, that you love them in spite of their ignorance, in spite of their own bondages, God, you love them. So Jesus, I just pray that you, for a breakthrough in the midst of this communion time this morning, that there would not be strife in your body, but Father, there would be wholeness, healing, that there'd be restoration and deliverance. So I speak to every relationship represented in this room right now. I speak life. I speak forgiveness. I speak unity. I speak healing. I speak restoration in Jesus' name. Let's partake of the bread together. Likewise, Jesus took the cup. And he said, "This is my blood." Every time we as a church partake of the cup, we are saying I do to the proposal of the groom. We're saying I do. You know there's a wedding feast? Are you aware of that? That one day there's a wedding feast and the bride of Christ and the groom. And those who surrender their life to Jesus, we are betrothed to another as a body. And what is so incredible is that his blood cleanses us from all unrighteousness. His blood cleanses from all guilt and all shame. It cleanses us from everything. He is the scapegoat. He said, well, somebody has to pay for my sin. Yeah, he did. So, Lord, we thank you for your blood. There's no cleansing agent on this planet in the universe that can wash away the stains of sin. But, Father, because of your grace, because of your sacrifice, Lord, your blood is poured over us. And not just enough, but more than enough. You so overpaid our ignorance. You so overpaid our trespasses and our transgressions. You so overpaid our sin. And we are so thankful. So we surrender to you, Lord, right now. And Holy Spirit, we just expose everything in our lives that does not agree with you. And we confess it to you right now. And we ask Jesus that you would make us complete in you in every way. In Jesus' name. Let's partake of the cup together. Let's sing that again.
Shout to everyone, come down.
this time, we'd like to take a break, meet and greet each other, fellowship for a few minutes.
We welcome you with praise, Almighty God of love.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning for our Sunday service. My name's Charity, if you haven't already met me. I'm usually back there. I have a great team back there that's doing wonderful things, helping us out. Thank you. And hello to everyone online. I'm just going to go over a few announcements with you. Please raise your hand if you do not have a bulletin, and one of our ushers will be happy to give you one. Inside your bulletin, you're going to find that we have a what we call a Discover card. It's a place where you can write down your information. We use that to stay in contact with you as you will. So go ahead and fill that out. On the back is the praise and prayer request section, so you can write down what you would like us to pray for. We would love to hear how our prayers are being answered too. So go ahead and share with us if you have any praise reports. You also are going to find that we have our May calendar in your bulletin as well. So this will list out some events we have going on, which I'll be sharing with you very shortly, as well as the fill-in notes for today. There's also fill-in notes on our Discovery Fellowship app, so you can do it digitally as well, especially for those who are watching us online. I try to make that available for them. On one side of your bulletin, you're going to see that we have our weekly schedule. On the other side is the upcoming events we have going on. More details are on that, as well as on our newsletter that goes out every week. First, I want to share with you HAD Ministries we have going on here Fridays at 7 p.m. We have our leaders here, so go ahead and raise your hands. We would love for our people to come talk to you if they need some support. So they're going to share in just a few minutes after I get done talking. I love to talk. All right. So ladies' breakfast, the ladies' brunch is happening this Saturday, May 12th at 9:30 a.m. That's happening here right downstairs in the fireside room. So it's a breakfast potluck style. So go ahead and bring a breakfast dish with you. And we would love for you guys to bring some friends. We're doing an awesome study, so I'm looking forward to that. Mother's Day, 1 hour service, Sunday, May 13th at 10:30 a.m. Make sure to write that down. We are not having a Saturday night service option. And men's conference is Friday through Saturday, May 18th through the 19th. So go ahead and mark your calendars down for that, all you guys. If you have any questions about that at all, please see Pastor Eric Roberts, as well as the ladies' brunch. We would love to make sure that we're knowing who's attending. So just Julie's back there, or you can write on your Discover card that you're planning on attending that. Ladies' Day Out is happening June 16th. Everybody's going to meet here at the church at 8 a.m., and then you're going to have go into the Pike's Place Market. Lunch will be at the Ivers over there on the way back. So if you have any questions, just please feel free to talk to Marianne or write down on your Discover card as well. We would love to keep track of who's wanting to attend that. And that's about it. Thank you.
So we had a request that was brought to the church a month ago. Boy, everything went everywhere, didn't it? And it was for our garden out here. And we are in great need of getting a automatic watering system. And we've done some research, and we found out the cost of that right now is being estimated at $250. We have $100 that's already come in. But we are needing another $150 to make this happen. And what that does is Jackie has spent literally hours a week trying to water this. And the automated system would do a couple things for us. One is it would save on our water. We conserve our water. But it would allow us with the gardening. Now, those that don't know what the garden, we have a community garden that's here. And all the proceeds of this goes to Kitsap Rescue Mission and the food bank. And so they go year-round with this. And if you are interested in being involved in that project with the planting and with just the process, you need to talk to Jackie. She's somewhere in the back. But if there's an interest, we're going to take an offer. If there's an interest to say, hey, I'd like to help with this gardening, we just don't have it at a general fund, we need about another $150 to make that happen. And so we have 100 towards it now. We're trying to get the remainder of that. If that would just kind of click your heart and say, you know, I'd like to help with that, just put that on the envelope, or you can either pledge it on an envelope if you don't have any cash today and say, hey, listen, this is my name. I'm going to pledge this amount for that, and just slip that in the offering plate. And us knowing that will help us to kind of determine when we go forth and getting the equipment that's there. Amen. I'm going to ask Brent and his wife to come up. They have a ministry called Had Ministries, and it's a great ministry, and they have been using our Friday nights, our facility down here, and I think it'd just be great for you to meet them and have an opportunity kind of to hear just a moment of what they're doing, and maybe you know somebody that might fit into that realm of what they're serving.
Thank you, Pastor Eric. First of all, we'd like to thank you and your church for allowing us to come in. Had is Hope for Addictions and Their Dependencies. What we are is a group of individuals that come together and share with each other our experiences, strengths, and hope, realizing and recognizing that Jesus Christ is the truth that will set us free. And we have like 7 principles that we're based upon, and they all coordinate with the steps of AA and NA. However, we believe that Jesus is the one that's truly going to set us free. That meeting is an amazing place to come together with like-minded people, whether it be AA, NA, or HAD. But the truth is the truth, and we don't deny that. And we believe that we can all come together and pray for one another and be each other and be a support. So if you know anybody who's struggling with drugs, alcohol, or anything, life, because life, I'm sorry, is a struggle. I mean, not a daily. It's real. And it can be a less of a struggle if you know that your friend or your companion is walking with you and beside you. So is there something you'd like to add?
Hi, I just want to say thank you guys for having us and allowing us to have the meeting here on Friday nights. And just to add something that we do is on Sunday mornings we go to the local recovery center in Port Orchard, and we bring a church service to the inpatients that are in recovery in there. So that's where Heather and I got connected with this ministry. We're both in recovery ourselves. I've got a little over 11 years, and Heather has got a little over 10 years. And we're both from this area. Well, Heather's originally from Michigan, but relocated because of the military. Again, just want to say thank you. And you know, I know that this is something that permeates our society. A lot of us, if we haven't been affected directly by this disease of alcoholism and addiction, we probably know somebody in our family or somebody that we're friends with that does struggle. So, you know, we know that Jesus can save us. So that's the message we're trying to put across.
So thank you. So if you have a neighbor or friend, 7 to 8:30 on Friday evenings, we'll be right here in the fireside room. So thank you.
We want to continue in our worship this morning by our giving. So I can have my ushers come forward. In Malachi 3, God tells us to test him. Test him. Bring our first fruits to him. Allow him to bless us through what we have given. I just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you for your generosity and your faithfulness. Lots of times, you know, when you're paying bills, it's kind of a nervous thing, you know, am I going to have enough? But God knows exactly how much we have, and he can take and multiply what you need and what this church body needs. So this morning, let's just lift up our offering to him. Just like Jesus fed the 5,000, he can meet our needs, can't he? Yes. Lord Jesus, we thank you. You have blessed us in so many ways. And this morning we are testing. We are giving back to you a small portion of what you've given to us. Lord, take this offering, bless it, multiply it to meet the needs of this people, and of this building. In your name we ask. Amen.
Watch that again. Amen. If you have your bulletins, the notes are in there. I'd like you to do me a favor, though. If anybody here have a smartphone or a tablet, would you just lift it up right now? You got a smartphone or a tablet. Would you do me a favor? Would you go to Facebook right now and check in at Discovery Fellowship?
Now, you say, why is that relevant? I want to tell you, that's a very relevant thing to do. And just check in, and if you want to say something nice, say something nice. That would be good, too, okay? So just, you know, I've been wanting to say that for weeks now. Just go ahead and check in, and that would be awesome. So I appreciate that. Good deal. We are going through the book of Acts this year, and we are in chapter 8, and we've been kind of jumping into this. I wanted to, if you have your bulletin, you have your Bibles, we're going to be in chapter 8 of Acts, and I want to read the passage that kind of is launching us today in his word. Amen? But so if you'd go ahead and stand with me, we're going to go ahead and read this. And I don't know if it's on the screen or not. It's not on screen. So, and I'm going to read the first 26. I think you have it in your notes. It comes in a little later. But it says, "Now the angel of the Lord said to Philip," Philip was one of the seven chosen deacons, not Philip the disciple, but he was the one we had talked about, had gone into Samaria, and many were finding Christ. You remember the story of Simon the sorcerer, that we had just came through that last time we talked. And it says, "Go south to the road, the desert road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." So the Lord came to him and said, "I want you to go down to Gaza." And so he started out on his way and met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship. And on his way home, he was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. It's really important to know that this guy must have been somebody of great stature because he had a copy of the letter of Isaiah. People didn't walk around with Bibles back then. You didn't have printing presses. So for him to have this was really interesting that he had a copy of Isaiah. And he says, and so the Spirit told Philip, "Go to that chariot and stay near it." And then Philip ran up to the chariot, and he heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. "Do you understand what you're reading?" Philip asked. "How can I," he said, "unless someone explains it to me?" So he invited Philip to come in and sit with him, and the eunuch was reading the passage of Scripture. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before the shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth. And the eunuch asked Philip, "Tell me, please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else?" Then Philip began with that very passage of Scripture, and he told him the good news about Jesus. As they traveled along the road, they came up near some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. Why shouldn't I be baptized?" I don't think Philip had an argument for that. And he gave orders to stop the chariot, and then both Philip and the eunuch went down to the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away. This is the Star Trek beam me up Scotty moment, right? And the eunuch did not see him again, but went on his way rejoicing. Philip, however, ended up 32 miles away from that spot and appeared in Azotus and traveled about preaching the gospel in all the towns until he reached Caesarea. Now, a lot of people get hung up on the beam me up Scotty moment. I don't want to get stuck there. There's another place I want to go with this, but let's pray. Father God, I pray that you just open our hearts and our minds today to grasp, Lord, the tools that you've given us to equip us to build your kingdom for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. So three things I want to grab a hold out of this to kind of note in this story is, number one is that Philip encountered a divine appointment as a result of being led by the Spirit. That was a divine appointment. How many would agree that was a divine appointment? The angel of the Lord came to him and said, "I want you to go down to Gaza." When he got there, the Lord says, "See that chariot? I want you to go stand by it." Has that happened to anybody? Has the Lord ever led you to do anything? I have to tell you, there are times that God has led me. I remember this one time I was driving down, and the Lord said, "I want you to go into that, pull into that restaurant there." And I said, "Lord, why?" He says, "I want you to go in there and sit down." I said, "I'm not hungry." He says, "Do it anyway." So I remember I pulled in the parking lot, got out of the car, and I walked in the restaurant. I don't even think I had any money that day. So I'm thinking, this is not good. It was a Mexican restaurant. And I'm like, what am I going to do? And I sat down. Within 2 minutes of sitting there, an individual came over, as bold as can be, sat down at my table, and within a couple minutes, we were talking about Jesus, and I led him to Christ. And the Lord just says, "See, you just need to be led of the Spirit. Let me lead you and watch what I will do through you." There are times I've been driving. The Lord said, "I want you to take a right," and he's gotten me lost, right? And I've ended up in places, but I was where he wanted me to be. And so being led of the Lord is an incredible thing. For Philip, he encountered a divine appointment because he was willing to be led of the Spirit. Sometimes we miss encounters because we're not willing to be led. If I'm not in control, it's not happening. But sometimes God says, listen, if you will surrender to my will and surrender and obey me, watch what I'll do. Number two is the eunuch was desperate for truth. This Ethiopian was heading to Jerusalem for worship, and he was reading Isaiah. He was looking for truth. And I will tell you this, everybody you know that is not considers himself a Christian, even those who would be considered hostile to the gospel. I have some atheist friends, and I want you to know, they are hungry, and they're looking for truth. We talk all the time, and doors open up, and it doesn't matter who they are. People are looking for truth. They are looking for the answers to life. And I believe that we have that in Christ. And Philip had that, and he had that full, and it's in his word. And so this eunuch was desperate for truth. But what did he say? Philip says, listen, do you understand what you're reading? And what was his response? How can I, he said, unless someone explains it to me. And I think that's where we're set, is unless somebody tells them the truth, how will they know, right? If not me, then who? If not now, then when, right? It kind of comes in there. The third thing is the eunuch was immediately looking for a way to respond. I think this is absolutely amazing. He was looking for a way to respond. And I think a lot of times we're trying to close the deal on something that God is already doing the work on. He's already doing the work on. You know, I remember Bob. I met Bob. Actually, the first time I met Bob was at his work in Gig Harbor. He contacted me, was it a week before we met, to receive Jesus. He contacted me. He says, will you meet with me? I'm trying to remember the details on that. But I drove to Gig Harbor. He provided lunch. We sat at a table. And he said, listen, unless you explain, will you explain this gospel to me? And at the end of that conversation, Bob bowed his head with me, and he prayed through the sinner's prayer, and Jesus came into his life. It was an incredible, and then his wife, all of a sudden, I get a call on a Tuesday, and I think I was at the fair, and his wife wanted to get saved too, and they were waiting for me to show up, and I'm thinking, Lord, it's there, you know? And so it was like the next week or a week or two later, his wife, I ended up at the house, and we led her through the sinner's prayer, and I have an opportunity to receive Christ. But people are hungry, and they're ready to respond. This eunuch was, you know, he heard the message of Christ, and he looks at water and says, where do I sign up? And I think a lot of people are looking for that, but a lot of Christians don't know how to close that gap. They don't know what to say. They don't know where to go. I remember a video I once saw that this church, everything went to the pastor. So every time somebody had a need, they went to the pastor and overwhelmed the pastor. The reality is God has called you as witnesses of his glory and his goodness and his truth. But we need to be equipped to be able to give that. Romans 10:17, I quoted it earlier this morning, is consequently faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. When people hear the word of God, not your opinion, not your religion, when they hear the life-giving word of God, there is something that connects with the spirit that needs to come back to life, that needs to be raised from the dead inside of them. As Jesus looked at Lazarus in the tomb and said, Lazarus, come forth. There's that spiritual connection in people's lives saying, there's something here. I want to grab a hold of it. The problem is most people who are looking for truth are turned off by those who claim to have it. Because Christians are the number one reason for atheism today. And I'll even go as far as to say religious people are the scariest people on the planet. They scare me more than anything. Remember, I walked into a youth group one time at church, and it was all these church kids, and I worked with kids in the streets with gangs. And those kids actually concerned me. I had fear because they had caught religion. They had missed Jesus and caught religion. And religious people are a downer. And I think the reason my atheist friends hang out with me is because they don't know what to do with me. They haven't been able to peg anything on me yet because they don't know where I fit. I don't fit in their box of what I should be. You know what I'm saying? And we shouldn't, because God has not called you to be religious. He's called you to be liberal in your walk with him and a witness to the testimony of who he is. People see you, they should see there's something different in you. If they don't, you need to get saved. Maybe you don't know what we're going to talk about, and you need to know that. Amen? So what I want to do is equip you, because I want to ask a simple question. How many here, don't need to raise your hand, but I want you to think about how many here have led someone to Christ through the word of God? Now, there's a few hands that will go up, and there's a few that won't. But I want to equip you this morning and say, so it's not by chance. It's a good week for you to be here. I told you it was going to be basic, but it's a good week because I want to walk you through the gospel, through scripture on how to lead someone to Christ. And a lot of people say, well, I don't lead people to Christ because I don't know how. Well, I want to take away that option for you. So when you leave here today, you can't say, I don't know how. Okay, and I want to make it really easy. How many have their Bibles with you today? Lift your Bible up. I'm going to make it really easy. What I'm going to give you is so easy. I'm going to show you a way that you will be able to take this message and be able to apply it. Now, you can do it here. You can take it home and grab a hold of it. But I want to tell you something. If you have your Bible, it is an awesome, awesome way to lead someone to Christ through the Bible. So if I was going to start somewhere, and we're going to start with something, what's the one scripture that we all have in our head that we never forget and we never stumble over? So I want you, if you have your Bibles, turn to John 3:16. I mean, you know why? Because it doesn't matter how nervous you're going to be, you're not going to miss that. It's like, where was that again? No, John 3:16. And you open up in your Bible, John 3:16. If you don't have your Bible here today and this intrigues you, when you get home, grab your Bible and do this. So open your Bible up to John 3:16 and underline that verse, because that's an important verse. And we're going to get back to it, but it's an important verse this morning. But that can be a starting point for you in sharing your faith with others. So somebody says it walks up to you, and believe me, if you are prepared, it will happen. If you are ready, God will send them. It's just the way it is. And so you open up your Bible. Somebody says, "Hey, I'd like to. How can I know this Jesus? How can I have a relationship?" Grab my Bible. You open up to John 3:16, and there's two questions you can write in the margin, or you can put on a piece of paper inside there. You can put your notes in there if you want. And then the two questions that you should ask. And these are really powerful questions. Let me give them to you. And that is this: if you were to die today, do you know that you would go to heaven? That's question number one. That's a relevant question. A lot of people will say, well, I'm not sure. That's a good question. And that's the point. If you don't know, we need to get to the second question. Now, some people will say, yes, you know, yeah, I'd go to heaven. And we'll talk about why people think. Did you know 87% of Americans consider themselves to be Christian? Do you believe that's a true figure to heaven? No. It's not. And so a lot of people think they're going to heaven that aren't. I saw a video yesterday, the Pope. A little kid came to the Pope, and his dad was an atheist. And he was really, his dad had just passed away. And he wanted to ask the Pope a question. And how many, anybody seen that? He wanted to ask the Pope a question, and the question was, he was hurting. You know, he wanted to know, is his dad in heaven? And so he couldn't say it out loud, so the Pope allowed him to come up, and he whispered in his ear. And in his ear, he kind of the situation. And when he got done, the kid kind of went off, and he sat down. And the Pope had gotten permission from him to share the story. And he says, listen, here's a boy whose dad was an atheist, but his dad made sure his kids went to church. He's a good man. This man's a good man because he got his kids in church, but he's died. And the boy wants to know, what is heaven for him? And the result of the Pope was because he was a good man, he goes to heaven. Okay, that was actually the result of that video of the Pope saying because he was a good man. And I want to tell you, most people think they're good people. Even evil people think they're good people at times, right? It says that in Psalms, it says actually in Proverbs, it says a couple times, a man thinks he know what is right. I'm paraphrasing, right? But in the end, it leads to death. What he thinks is right, and he's good, but in the end, he leads to death. So you say, well, you're talking to a person. Say, well, you know, Pastor, there's a lot of people I've talked to. They think they're Christian, but I don't see the fruit in their life, and I don't know where they want to go. So that question you write in there says, if you were to die today, do you know you're going to heaven? A lot of people say yes. The second question is a defining question. And you can write this in the margin of your notes, and that is this: if you were to die today and stand before God, why should he say he should let you into his heaven? Why would he let you into his heaven? Now, that's a defining question. Because at that point, it's because I'm a good person, right? Because I deserve to go to heaven, right? We have a lot of confusion in the church and a lot of confusion in America. And the reality is, why should God let you into his heaven is a defining question. And for most people, they say, well, it's because I'm a good person. Well, what does the Bible say about this? So here's what I would do is if you have your Bible or you get your Bible later, next to John 3:16, somewhere in the margin, write the first scripture. And what this does is it becomes a daisy chain. So if you can get to John 3:16, you can get to the first question. You'd write the first scripture in the margin. Then they would go to that scripture, and you would write the next scripture in the margin of that scripture. Does that make sense? That's kind of the idea, and you can actually walk somebody through. Now, the video we just saw was Romans Road. Did you know that you could lead someone to Christ only in the book of Romans? That's kind of amazing. And that's where those are. And a lot of these scriptures are there. But let me give you some scriptures to look at. And so what do you do with the person who considers himself to be a good person and isn't that enough? Because a lot of people in our culture, a lot of people in our society think that all of us deserve to go to heaven. Isn't that good enough? Except this, in Romans 3:23, and that's the scripture you would write in the margin of John 3:16, is in Romans 3:23, it says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Man cannot reach God. You know what I love about that verse? That verse totally deplorizes religion. Because you say, what is religion? Religion, it doesn't matter if it's Buddhism, it doesn't matter if it's Mohammedism, it doesn't matter if it's Hinduism, it doesn't matter if it's Catholicism, it doesn't matter if it's Judaism. All religion is man trying to reach God. But what does the Bible say? All have fallen short of the glory of God. So we cannot reach him. That, you know what that says? That says that all religion is worthless. And because of that, we can't reach it. In fact, he goes on in actually chapter 3, verse 10, just a few verses earlier in that, in Romans 3:10, it says, as it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. So there is no good person. And it doesn't matter how good a person is, they're still not good enough. Did you know that Santa Claus doesn't even get to heaven based on his merits? Because there's no good person. Man is not good within himself. So we end up, we look at, so I would write that verse in there. Now, if you take this home, you can pick out the verses and kind of the flow with this, but I want to help you to be able to walk somebody through Scripture. And here's the key. Don't read it to them. When I'm open the Bible and I go to the Scripture, I have them read the Word. There's something about the Word, not you, that connects and is powerful. I let them read it. And then as they read it, I allow them to soak it in because they can listen to you reading it and tune you out. But if they're reading it, they're connecting it somehow. There's an engagement in the Word, and that's what transforms lives. Amen? So you say, well, why is no one good? Well, we know that in the beginning, God had created Adam and Eve, and they were perfect and good. But we know that this thing called the fall, right? And because of sin, our world is separated. A lot of people have come to me and said this. If there's a God, why is there so much suffering in our world? How can you say you believe in a God when all of the suffering is out there? And that's a great question. How many have ever asked that question? It's a fair question. And the answer to that question is real simple, is because the world we live in is not the world God created. The world we live in is the world that is a result of man's sin. And because of that, the world we live in is separated from God. Therefore, the world God created and the world we live in are two separate things. And so we look at this. It says in Romans 5:12, therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and the death through sin, and in this way death came to all men, because all sinned. So we know that because of Adam, who is the first of man, set the tone for the rest of us. So should we be angry at Adam? Well, we have to realize, I don't know how it's going to help. You can have all the unforgiveness in the world with Adam, but it's not going to help. He's been gone a long time. Okay? But the reality is, why did Adam sin? Is because he was not going to leave woman behind. Okay? So it was she ate the apple. Yeah, he wasn't gonna be left behind without her, right? So people want to blame women, but I want to tell you something. Men had their own purposes, and that was what created the reality there. 1 John 1:5 says this: "This message we have heard from him and declare to you: God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth." Well, you might have somebody say, well, you know what? I'm a good person. I don't have any dark secrets in my closet. I should go to heaven because I don't have any dark, deep secrets in my closet. And there's some people that may not have that, and that's okay. But it still doesn't get us there, because the reality is this, is it's not good enough to be good enough, because our good enough, even our best, isn't good enough. So if you've broken, the Bible, James says this, if you've broken one command, you're guilty of breaking them all. So a person says, well, I'm a good person. You say, okay, have you ever heard of the Ten Commandments? These are the commandments. God says, unless you fulfill all these commandments, you can have nothing. Right? Yeah. And so we go through, and what are the commandments? Thou shall what? Thou shalt love the Lord your God. Already half of them are already out of the picture. Especially those who deny him, right? By the way they live their life. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not lie. Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt, we can go down the list, right? James says this. James, this is a powerful verse. James 2:10 says, for whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking it all. So you say, well, I'm a good person, but you may be a good person, but you're guilty. Because there isn't anybody on the planet outside of Christ that hasn't broken one of the Ten Commandments. And the fact that he's broken one of them, you've broken them all. And at that point, you aren't good enough. Right? So you might say, well, is sin really that big a deal? And if so, what hope can we have? If we're separated from God, we can't reach God, right? And sin is in our way, and we know sin is that we've broken the commandments. What hope do we have? And if I can't go to church or I can't work my works to get there, what hope do we have? And it says in Romans 6:23, and this is a good verse as well. Most of you know this verse. By the way, all of you should have these verses memorized, okay? These are base verses. If you've been in Christ for more than 5 years and you don't have these memorized, you need a new discipleship plan for yourself, okay? You need to start memorizing these verses. Listen to this. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, the Jews understood this because do you know how they dealt with their sin? They would bring a lamb to the altar, and the altar would, and the lamb would be slaughtered, and it would be killed, and it would be in place of their sin. Death had to happen. We know that our death isn't good enough, right? And those who do not receive Christ, those who do not connect the gospel, that are separate from God for eternity, are into what we call eternal death. So it isn't fair for anyone actually not to go to hell, but the reality is the wages of sin is death. Therefore, because there's sin in our lives, there is a price to be paid. But we know that there's an eternal gift through Jesus Christ our Lord. There's a gift that's been given. And so we talk about what is the good news. The good news is the reality of our state is where we are, but God has given us a hope. He's given us an opportunity. You say, well, you don't know where I've been. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what you've claimed. Because what Jesus has done and the gift that he's given is greater than your circumstances. It's greater than your past. It's greater than your relationships. It's greater than your choices. It's greater than what you've done or not done. So we find out that God has given a plan. I love this verse, Romans 5:8. But God demonstrates his love toward us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While I was still shaking my fist in his face, saying, I hate you by the way I live my life, God says, I'm going to die for you anyway. God didn't just die for the righteous. He died for the unrighteous. Come on. He didn't just die for some. He didn't just die for Jews. That's why it says in John 3:16, for God so loved some people. For God so loved the Jews only. For God so only loved the righteous people. No, it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish but have eternal life. So we realize there's a plan that's in place, and that plan of salvation that God intends and has made a way for every one of us to walk into that hope of his gift. Everyone has that opportunity. Jesus on the cross, even as he was hanging on the cross, as he was scapegoating for our sins. And he said, it is finished. In Luke 23:34, it says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. His life was paid as a ransom for ours. We read that in Isaiah 43 this morning. So a person might come to that point to where the Ethiopian came. Might come to the point to where when Peter stood up in the on Acts chapter 2 with the day of Pentecost and he began to preach. And what did the people do? They were cut to the heart, it says. And they said, what shall we do to be saved?
The Ethiopian looked at Philip and he heard the gospel of Jesus and immediately says, how can I be saved? What do I need to do? What's the next step? Sometimes people are ready for the next steps, but nobody's there to give it to them. How can I be saved? Salvation is a gift. It's not something we earn. I love Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourself. It is the gift of God, not by works that no one can boast. Nothing you do can save you. It's not about you. It's about what he is doing. It's about what he has done. And simply understanding that his grace is sufficient and that his gift in what he has done is sufficient. So what do you do? Well, Paul says in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. It is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. Now, I'll just say this. When does a person get saved? When they've said a prayer? It's the moment their heart connects with Jesus. See, I believe, Bob, when you called me and said, let's get together because I want to give my heart to the Lord, that's when your name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life. The days later that we prayed together, all we were doing was catching up with what God and you had already done. I was already there. My dad, for years, I prayed for my father. He wanted nothing to do with God. I couldn't use the name of God in my house. He would take the distributor out of my car to keep me going from youth group. My dad was like just anti-God for something. He got real hostile before he got saved. But I'll never forget, I was praying. I was in Bible college. I come home, and I was praying over my house. I was anointing it with oil, and all of a sudden, this one night, it was a Sunday night. My dad worked overtime. He worked at Boeing. He retired from Boeing. And he walks in the house, and he looks at my mom and I, and he says, I'm going to go take a shower. I'm getting dressed. We're going to church. I'm giving my heart to Jesus. My mom looked at me, and I looked at my mom and said, did you hear what I just heard? I think so. We went to church, and I realized that our church didn't do altar calls on Sunday night, you know? They did them on Sunday morning. I thought, oh, no, what are we going to do? All of a sudden, the pastor closes the service. About 500 people there. The pastor closes the service in prayer. My dad gets up. I'm following my dad to the altar. And I had the opportunity as a 19-year-old to lead my dad to Jesus. Now, when did my dad get saved? Somewhere along the day before he got home and said, I'm going to go home, I'm going to take a shower, I'm going to get dressed, we're going to church, I'm going to get home. That's when it took place in his heart. That confession took place in his heart in that moment. There is no formula. But why it is important. And why is confession important? Because really it begins with a word called repentance. Salvation begins with repentance. It's when we recognize that we are not good enough. It's when we recognize that we have transgressed against God. It's in that moment that repentance comes in our heart, that we see the sin the way God sees it in our lives, and it's in that moment it begins the confession out of our mouth, and confession is simply agreeing with God. We're already guilty. All we're doing is agreeing with what God already knows. But I love what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 7:10. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation. It's when we look and say, I am in need of a Savior. I'm in need of something more because in myself, I can't achieve this. And it says, and leaves no regret. Now, let me read that again. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. I have never found a person who has ever surrendered their life to Jesus and regretted it. Never. I have found many people who surrendered to religion and regretted it, but I've never found someone to surrender to Jesus and regret it. There is no regret. So you say, well, where do you go from here? You have that conversation. You might ask a person, would you like to receive Jesus into your life? Now, that Paul says in 1 Corinthians that some are to water and some are to sow and some are to plant and some are to
to harvest, right? We don't know. God has never called us to go out and save people. That's not ever, nowhere in the Bible said go save people. It doesn't say that. One, we can't save people, right? But two, all we're called to be is obedient. And sometimes that conversation with someone is simply we're sowing a seed. Or maybe we're watering a seed that has already been sowed in their lives. Every once in a while, we harvest. Every once in a while, I don't know who did the legwork for Bob. It wasn't me. Bob had heard the truth somewhere. Something had moved Bob, and it wasn't me. I didn't do the watering and sowing in Bob's life. I'm sorry I'm using you, Bob, but, you know, you're here. So, you know. And so what happened with Bob was, boom. It was just a matter of I got to opportunity to harvest something that somebody else had sowed and seeded. He probably knows who that was. And so the reality is all we're called to be is obedient, whether we're watering, sowing, or seeding, or harvesting. Just be obedient. I may share Christ with somebody. My atheist friends, I preach to all the time, but I do it in a way that's not preachy. And they ask me. I've stood out here with a couple of them. They stood there, and we're talking about the bill, and all of a sudden, it moves over into life, and pretty soon, I'm bringing in Jesus, you know, what he's done in my life. And I kind of let it sit there and see if it goes anywhere. And where it goes, it kind of moves, and they receive it. You know, this is kind of where we're at. You know, it's kind of moving through. God hasn't called me to save them. He's just called me to be a witness to who he is in front of them. Amen? So you say, well, somebody says, I want to receive Christ. What do I do? Call pastor. No! The truth lives in you. So I've given you kind of a basic prayer. Do they have to pray this prayer? No. But here's a basic prayer. And after I wrote this, I thought, you know what? I could have done a better job. But here, check this out. Here's a prayer you could lead them through. And a lot of times with a person, if a person's rededicating their life, I have them pray. Because they know. I say, you know what? What I'd like you to do is why don't you just pray right now out loud, and I'm going to agree with you. And when you're done, I'm going to pray for you. If it's a person who has not received Christ in their life, I will have, well, I'll tell you what, would you just repeat after me? The reason why is I can't pray the prayer for you. You have to pray the own prayer, amen? Now, do you have to pray the prayer to be saved? No, because that's all in your heart. But why is this important to do the prayer? I think it's mostly important because it's what allows us to be able to look at the enemy and say, get behind me, Satan, because this truly did happen. There's confession that was here, and I was there. And if we don't bring it to that point, sometimes people don't know what that rite of passage is. Does that make sense? And so bring it to a point of rite of passage where they come forward in a service, where they pray a prayer, whatever it may be, there's a rite of passage that the enemy can't dissuade from us from ever happening. Amen? So here's a prayer. Jesus, just repeat this after me. Jesus, I recognize I have sinned against you and broken your commandments. I believe that you died on the cross for me, and in faith, I ask you to come into my life. Take away all my sin, guilt, and shame, and become the Lord and Savior of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. That's it. Now, are we looking for warm fuzzies every time? No, but I will tell you this. When a person in their heart does that, there's an incredible supernatural thing that happens. And it's something that happens without you. It's not about you. All we've done is kind of pointed them in a direction. And now they're connecting with the Father. And I want to tell you, that's a powerful thing. And if you've not had the opportunity to walk somebody through that, you are missing out. I want to tell you, you want to get charged in your faith, watch somebody get saved. Watch them get transformed. Because there's nothing like it. Well, they might say, well, how do I know God has heard my prayer? That's a fair question, isn't it? Because most people who come to Christ haven't exactly all the time learned to recognize his voice in their lives. God talks to you? What are you, Joan of Arc? Because a lot of people don't understand that God speaks to his people through his word. And we begin to define his voice from all the other voices on our... I hear my mama's voice in my head all the time. And she's in Arizona, and I'm not on a phone call with her, but I still hear her voice. Burger King and McDonald's have a voice in my head somewhere. Whether it's done your way or my way or whose way, I don't know. There's a voice in my head. All kinds of voices roam around in there. But being able to recognize Jesus' voice in my life. I love a story, Barry McGuire. Some of you know who that is. He was a huge singer that got saved back in the loves. Yeah, just incredible. He had a story. He was up in Alaska fishing, and he tells a story before he found Christ. And he was out one day, and they were kind of hanging out, had some time off, and all of a sudden this dolphin came up to the boat, and he just got so excited. So he ran inside, and he got a towel, and he put a knot on the end of it, and he waded and went out to the edge of the boat. And next time the dolphin came by, he just came out, and he slapped that dolphin right across the back of that dolphin with this towel. Dolphin came out of the water looking back. I'm like, wait, what was that? The dolphin kind of swam off. He's like, oh, man, scared him away. He says, about an hour later, all of a sudden, an entire school of dolphins showed up. He said for the next 45 minutes, he was just bapping them left and right as they were coming by. It's like and Barry's thing was, it was like he went and said, I got one over here, guys, come on over here, you know. And he just had this incredible day of just bapping these dolphins with a towel on the edge of this boat. He says, one by one, the dolphins began to swim away, and it was just that one dolphin that kind of hung around. He kind of felt like that was the same dolphin, the first one that came out. And he swam away, and he's sitting there, and he says, and I loved it because he made this statement. He says, I didn't know the voice then, but I've learned to recognize the voice now to be the Lord and Savior of my life. He says, hey, Barry, I made them for you. Wow. A lot of times a person comes to Christ, they haven't quite learned to recognize his voice. But you say, well, how do we know he's heard my prayer? Well, it says in Romans 10:13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. It's not like I called on his name and he decided I didn't fit the parameters and I'm not good enough. None of us are good enough, guys. Paul was a Christian beater killer. I mean, if there was a guy that did not belong in the kingdom of God, it was Paul the Apostle. This guy had papers to go and torment the church. He was the number one uno maruno enemy of the church that Jesus got a hold of and transformed him from the inside out. John 1:2 says, yet all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Do you know when a person asks Jesus into their life, when they surrender their life to Jesus, the Bible says that your name, their name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life by the blood of Jesus. It cannot be reserved. So that's it says that. Now check this out. 2 Corinthians 5:17. If you don't know this verse, you should have this memorized. This is one. I preach on this one all the time. I love this passage. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if you are in Christ, you are what? A new creature, a new creation. And the old is gone and the new has come. He transforms us from the inside out. There is no greater miracle. There is no greater supernatural thing you can see than a person being transformed from the inside out into a new creature in Christ. Some of you, I am so glad that you know Jesus. When I first met Kirk, there was little Jesus in him, but there was a lot of the pre-Jesus going on in his life. I remember walking down the street of Bremerton one day, and he looked at me and says, you know, I'm just doing everything I can. I just want to bust that window out of that guy, pull that guy out of the car and take his car. I'm like, Kirk, we need to talk. Right? Of course, I think he was still in addiction back then, those days. But Jesus got a hold of him, and he's transformed. It's awesome. And he changes us from the inside out. It's wonderful. How do we know he's heard his prayer? Because his word says he hears our prayer. So what's next? Well, the Ethiopian looked at Philip and said, hey, there's some water. Why shouldn't I get baptized? I love that. Why shouldn't I just commit more to Christ? You know, the first two questions I gave you were from a ministry called Evangelism Explosion. There was a church over in Redmond back in the early 80s that used that ministry of those two questions. If you were to die today, do you know for a fact that you would go to heaven in number two? If you were to stand before God and ask him, he was to ask you, why should I let you into heaven? What would you say? Those two questions, that church built their church on those two questions. You know how big their church became? Over 10,000 people. It was the largest church at that time on the West Coast on those two questions. I heard a story one time the pastor was sharing. I was in my master's level. The pastor of that church had came and talked to us. And he was talking about a couple in his church, and they would go door to door and talk to people, stand at the door. And that was kind of, now the Jehovah's Witness go through with their Watchtower stuff, but they would go and just say, hey, just want to ask you a couple questions. And it would be those two questions. This one guy, they prayed with him to receive Christ. And he looked at me and says, so what's next? And they wanted to dumb it down because they didn't want to push him too hard. He's a baby Christian, you know, he just came to Christ. And he says, wait a minute. He says, I didn't just subscribe to a magazine. I described to the king again, I expect my resources, I expect my money, and they were just kind of taken up. This guy's commitment had exceeded their commitment and immediately when they came to Christ. And that's kind of what happened with Ethiopian. He looked at Philip and goes, why shouldn't I be baptized? Philip's like, I don't know. Let's go, right? And I'll tell you what, when Jesus gets a hold of a person's life, you better hold on because you're gonna be trying to keep up to what Jesus wants to do in and through them. Amen. You say, well, what is baptism? I love Matthew 10:32. Jesus said this, whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge him before the Father in heaven. I believe baptism is that. It's confessing Christ before men. And if you've not been baptized and you have accepted Christ, I encourage you to consider that. We set up a baptismal and bring that confession before him because it's just a good place of obedience. But it's a level of commitment. We commit our lives to Christ, not just a label. We don't wear a T-shirt or a bumper sticker. To follow Christ means we become a disciple of Jesus. And, you know, I remember sitting with a group in college and we were wrestling, when has a person been evangelized? That was the question we asked. Is it when we've shared Christ with them? They said, well, no. Is it when they receive Christ? Well, no. Because when they receive Christ, how many newborns have we left on the streets? What would happen if a mother had a baby and just left it on the street in the middle of November? It would die, you know, and we do that with a lot of people. That's part of the reason I don't use tracts that often. I'm not a tract guy. Some people like to hand out tracts. And you know what? More power. There's good. Get the word. I have a lot of people I've known that found Christ through you know, gospel tract. But I like to build redemptive relationships because you know what? Once I have an opportunity to watch you come to Christ, I want to rear you in that relationship and found you in his word. You know when a person is evangelized? It's not when we've done the big crusade and they've come forward to receive him. It's when those who we've reached have going out reaching others. That is when we've evangelized. And I think there's just come a point, we're responsible to those that we water and those we sow and those we harvest. Amen? We're responsible to the harvest, to the fields that are there. And so I just want to close this morning. And this weekend, the Lord has just really been stirring me on speaking life. I was telling the prayer team this morning, just speaking life over our people. What I'd like to do is, how many, if you're here this morning, every head bowed, every eyes closed, and you'd say, you know what, I would like an opportunity to close a deal with someone for Christ. I would like to lead someone to Christ. Nobody's looking around. I know this is a little different. I want you to stand up. Just stand up. Say, because I want to pray for you. I want to pray for those who like to lead someone to Christ, be able to have that opportunity to lead someone to Christ. Say, it's time for me to step out of being the reached and become a person of influence to reach others. And if that's you, just stand up right now because you know what? Jesus so wants to use you and to partner with you to build his kingdom. He wants to use you to be a witness to those around you. What Jesus has done in your life, he wants to do in someone else's. Now, you may be here this morning and say, you know what? I'm not sure I have Jesus figured out in my life. And that's so simple. Just as I talked about right in just a moment, it's the matter of confessing our heart, saying, Jesus, come into my life. Become the ruler of my life. In that moment, he washes everything away. Lord, forgive me for where I was last week. Forgive me for the things, the guilt. And the Lord says, my blood is sufficient for you. But you say, you know what? I want to be able to pray with someone. I want to be able to share with someone. I want to become a sower. I want to become a water. I want to become a harvester of the kingdom of God. Jesus told his disciples that I'm going to make you fishers of men and women. So Jesus, I just pray for these here that are standing right now. I impart your word. I impart your spirit upon them this morning. And I ask Jesus, as they take a steadfastness to begin to pray for the lost, We pray for Bremerton. We pray for Kitsap County, Father. We pray for the dark places in our community, the places that have been left behind, the places that have been shut off. We pray for them right now, and we ask God that you, by your hand, would bring your light into the darkness. And that, Father, the light of men, the light of the world would shine through us and become an incredible power pack to what you want to do in those around us. I pray that you would fill your people with your word. I pray that you'd fill your people with your boldness, Lord. As we've talked about the Holy Spirit in the last few weeks, and I pray that your Holy Spirit would come down upon your people and a mighty boldness would come upon them, Father, not to become offensive to those around them, but, Father, to love this generation, to love the sinners right where they are, to love the lost right where they are, to let you do the work in their lives, but, Lord, to allow us to simply show your love. I pray that you would equip your people with your word. That, Father, that your people would be able to share your word, to through your word bring the light of the message of the cross to this generation. And I pray for opportunity right now. Every head's bowed, every eyes closed. I want to encourage you today, if you do nothing else, that when you go home today, that you take out a piece of paper and that you write from the top of the paper to the bottom of the paper, entitle the paper, The 10 Top Most Wanted. And put 1, 2, 3, and fill that paper up with 10 people that you know that do not know Jesus. And I challenge you, I dare you, I ask you to and plead with you to write their names down of those people you know that don't need to, and begin to pray for them every day this week. Say, Jesus, I pray that you would lay hold of their hearts and their souls and their minds. Lord, give me opportunity to be a witness into their lives. Give me an opportunity to speak life into them. Show me how to love them. Show me how to be you in the midst of them. Show me to show them who you are through the way I live and the words I speak. Help me to become a testimony of your goodness. You begin to do that, and I will tell you something. Your relationship with them will change. Your relationship, it doesn't mean you need to preach to them. God is not saying, I want you to bore them with religion. But he is saying, if you'll let me work through you, that opportunity is you'll start seeing divine appointments. If God can lead Philip to the Gaza and then beam him 32 miles away to another place to be with someone else, God can directly order your steps and lead you to someone somewhere. My wife and I were sitting in a restaurant last week down in Seaside, Oregon. This young lady, her name was Allie. Allison was her full name. Beautiful young lady. When I saw her, the Lord showed me, not just showed me her, he showed me her past. He showed me things around her prophetically. And we were getting ready to eat, and I said, Allie, I said, you know, we're going to pray. Is there anything we can pray for you? And she stopped, and there were some other tables. I think they kind of stopped talking, and they were kind of looking at us. And she says, I said, I'm sorry. I know it's kind of weird, but we believe in prayer. And I just sense that God wants to do something in your life. And she sat back, and she says she did, and she gave us a prayer request. And we prayed for her, and we prayed that God would bless her. And I looked at her and said, you know, you need to know something. Because I would tell God was just really speaking some things into her life. And she looked at us. She came back to our table. She says, listen, I'm going to be here all week. If you come back, come and look for me. I'm going to be here all week. I can't tell you how many times that's happened. Somebody speaking life into someone. You never know the opportunity of what God has for you until you step out and let him be who he is in you. Amen? When you go to the store next time, don't just go to the store looking for what you as a consumer. Go there and look around and say, God, who do you want me to talk to? And if you don't know how to do that, call Patty right back here. Call Patty and say, Patty, will you let me go to Walmart with you or Fred Meyer? Can I go to Fred Meyer with you? And I just want to follow you around. And watch what God does through her, and you know what? You'll get it. Right? Because Patty's a pit bull, man. She looks for an opportunity, and she seizes it. I love it. We at our home group on Sunday nights, she shares her stuff. And I'm usually, she just encourages me because I'm like, Jesus, you're doing so much in her life. By the way, we have home group tonight, 5 o'clock, Vertiface. Jesus, I just right now commission your people right now with your word. Equip them. Use them. Show them. Father, your glory and your goodness and the influence around them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you for coming today. God bless you. I went over, but, you know, what an opportunity. Remember, next week is same time, but it's just going to be a condensed service, 1 hour. And so you guys have a wonderful day. Amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless. And share all good things.